Hey y'all, welcome back to the Musicality Agenda. I'm Craig Havokhurst, and we're cruising through part two of my conversation with Sofia Goodman. She's a composer, a drummer, and a band leader in Nashville, Tennessee. At part one, you could hear about her background and sort of the beginnings of our conversation about the process of composing and composing. In a sense, Sofia, you were telling me that when you're in composing mode, you never mentioned the drums at all. You talked about melody, you talked about laying out the parts, you playing the piano to get a harmonic idea. When does the drumming become front of mind for you in that process? Or is it sort of there all along? Or does it really take shape more once I've got the shape of this, I've got the phrasing, I know where the emphasis points want to be. When does the drumming come in?
It's always different to be honest. Sometimes I do start with a groove, but usually, like I was saying before, it is melody based. And then I guess once I get sometimes the if I get the harmony down, I can get a bass line. Sometimes that will inform the drum pattern. But sometimes it just kind of appears within, a few seconds after I'm kind of just already thinking. I kind of like maybe beatbox it a little bit while I'm playing, think about it that way. And then I'll just hop on my kit and I'll imagine it in my head. I'll imagine what I was playing on the piano and I'll just kind of fool around. Sometimes I'll record into Logic. The program that I was talking about before, the melody and the chords, and then I'll hop on the kit and I'll just try some stuff out and just see what feels good as well. So it's a lot of different processes.
And then, is there a way that you can describe the role of the drummer, of your part in the band, once that tune is complete and performance ready? As you're playing, I think I want to get folks to think beyond the notion of the drummer as the timekeeper. It's so baked into the way we hear pop music. The drummer is not forward and making a statement that is in any way equal to the lead singer, the lead guitar player. So we kind of tend to put the drummer in the background of our mental map of music. But in jazz especially, and I like to think in a lot of other forms of music too, the drummer's playing a much more active role. So where would you take that?
Yeah, I think that the drummer is the energy keeper of the band. We have a lot to do with the dynamics as well.
When the energy surges, the volume surges, when things lay back and get quieter.
Yeah, definitely that can definitely be part of it. Dynamics are really important. I think drums just especially live drums, like they just bring an energy that electronic drums, it's I think it's I'm not like against electronic drums. I love technology. But I think just it's hard to beat that, no pun intended, reverberance of the drum and how that feels.
Well, why don't we take an example here? I'm not gonna play the whole thing, play about the first minute 20 seconds or so. The composition is called Sweetness Itself from your album Myriad of Flowers, which came out in 2018. And I would urge folks to listen. There's an intro, then listen for the way the drums actually introduce themselves in the piece about 20 seconds in. And then I'll cut it off when it seems like a good time to talk about it. Sounds good?
Sounds good.
Okay. I think we'll leave there. Such a nice tune. And what we heard was a piano intro. Then you bring the drums in with sort of a roll, sort of a crush roll that brings you in, along with what I guess we'll call the theme, right? The actual core melody. Starts with a saxophone, then we move on to guitar and then a keyboard. And walk us through a little bit about the moments when, you know, you had to create that piano part. That's a written part, right? To that mm-hmm. introduction. So take us through from there.
Yeah, I mean, I just kind of get on to the piano and just start composing what I hear in my head. I just kind of what I hear in my head, I have the ability to put it into writing, and a lot of that is thanks to the training that I've had with music school and being able to read and write music. So
yeah,
I just let it come through. It's supposed to be really kind of mellow. There's something that seems kind of French to me, like in a weird way. And I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just the romanticness of the melody. But I always imagined like gondola or gondolas. What are those little boats? You know what I'm talking
well,
about?
The gondolas would be, it would take us to Italy and in Venice. The poles. If I'm in France, I think of that Monet painting and maybe somebody's on a little flat bottom boat and, you know, kind of rowing along amid the flowers and a beautiful day. But I get it. Yeah, sort of pastoral feeling. To get a little analytical about it, it sounds like the tune is in 6/8 time. Santa da 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 da. So not three time, not waltzy time, but where each of those 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 kind of has our cycle around that. And that's a chance to kind of share with folks that while musicians can and often do that kind of analysis to sort of get a little grounding, it becomes a point where it's, you're not doing it to, you know, show off to yourself or to make an intellectual point to yourself or to tell anybody. It's more like, you know, where you're grounded in the flow of the music. It gives you a sense of where the phrases begin and how many kind of phrases there are in a cycle. And it's just like orientation. So that's the reason I ask about the time signature. And then what also stands out about this is on the harmonic language is this doesn't have a conventional tonal place where we all know we are home and there's the one and we're going to go up to 5 and then back to 1, which is sort of the standard Western harmonic thing you'd hear in pop songs, country songs. There's that key that really, you know, you could identify it and hum it. This floats more. What's going on?
Yeah, a lot of the music that I write is not tonally centered. I think because I am a drummer, I have a different approach to harmony. So sometimes my husband is a guitar player, and he talks about sometimes that it's hard for him to kind of escape sometimes his harmonic tendencies or just kind of training. So it's almost kind of like my lack of harmonic knowledge in a sense. That sounds bad, but it kind of freed me up to think about things in a little bit of a different way. I do love studying harmony in theory, but it doesn't dictate what I write. I just kind of follow the flow of it.
At the same time, that song, Sweetness Itself, it establishes what I like to call a tonality, a set of tones that are consistent. It doesn't just go all over the place. I've often encouraged people, if they're hearing music that feels disorienting on the harmonic side, the notes and where is home, where is the ground, at least listen for the feeling that the intervals between those notes are consistent and that the kind of tonality has a sort of feeling that carries through the piece. And that if you kind of inhabit that and get into that tonality, then you're in a place where you're listening to what happens within it. And that there's other ways of getting, of feeling like you're on home ground in listening to music. That's not just dun, 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 dun. And, that part of the exercise in growing your musical vocabulary and your listening vocabulary and your scope is to begin to get into some of those that feel a little disorienting, but you go, I've been here a little while. And, you know, I see that the same sorts of ideas and intervals and tones keep coming at me, and I can live here. I can feel comfortable now. You see, you think that's, am I getting at something there that you recognize?
Yeah, I think that, it can be exciting as a listener just to challenge yourself to listen to different pieces. And I think as the more you listen to different types of music, the more that your ear will develop and be able to find familiarity in any piece of music.
Absolutely. The phrase acquired taste from the world of food completely applies. If you don't like bourbon the first time you taste it, by the eighth time you might like it a whole lot, and that goes on. Excuse me. Let's extend that into talking about how to orient people to music that doesn't have the comfort of a song and a singer in it. You've dedicated, now you may work with, you said you've sung in the past, and you may, some of your work even on the record that's coming up may have vocals, I don't know, but what I know of you is you're an instrumental musician. And instrumental music is a very small part of the music marketplace. It is a disadvantaged part of the music ecosystem, as I argue, in the media. The media does not fill people that understand it, so they don't convey it. And we've lost a lot of the music critics, the jazz writers, the classical writers at daily newspapers. And so there's less of a dialogue with the public about instrumental music than there used to be in the 1960s, when people like Thelonious Monk got on the cover of Time magazine and the world of media was saying, pay attention to these people, even though they're not singers of songs. I see us as being in a culture of the last 25, 30 years where the singer and the song were always the star and the front piece, and people grow up in that environment. And they think, well, what else would I relate to? What's your, how would you encourage people? What's your observations about instrumental music that it might help make it more relevant and exciting to people?
Yeah, I personally like being out in nature a lot, and you can feel a certain way in being out in nature. And I think that instrumental music is similar in that sense, that it's really about how you feel and how it could make you feel. And maybe it might make you feel inspired or just appreciative of the beauty in nature. I definitely understand that people listen to music and they want to put on a song that says, you know, charges them up to go do whatever they're wanting to go do in the world. And so that makes a lot of sense to me, or it can easily relate to people. But I think for me, it's all about listening to the music and seeing how that makes you feel. And sometimes you can tell a story, or you can talk about, you could just talk about a story. My new album that I'm working on is ocean inspired. So if somebody's wanting to kind of get that vibe or connect to the ocean, it might be a good album for them to check out.
Makes a lot of sense. If you think about mood, I also have grown over the years. It took me a long time to kind of grasp this, but when I hear a soloist, the saxophone, the guitar solo, the drum solo, I used to think of it as sort of in a musical box. And over time, I began to relate it to the idea of somebody who was on a stage, like a preacher or a professor or hopefully a good-natured politician, exhorting the crowd, an audience, to follow the flow of their energy. Or a monologue in a Shakespeare play. If you can listen to the energy and the flow and the beats of the way they speak, and if it was in a foreign language or the actual words were dropped out, you'd still feel as the audience a lot of the intent and the emotional and energy. So that's going on too.
Yeah, there's definitely a conversation that happens amongst the musicians during solos. Yeah.
Can you elaborate on that just a little bit? How you listen to each individual soloist and even the soloists who have taken their turn and they've stepped back and they may not actually be playing, but they're very involved in what's going on, right?
Yeah, really you're trying to follow the soloist, play things that complement them, not get into their way with it. So, maybe if they take some space, maybe I do a fill or something and give them some kind of idea. Or maybe I can flip the beat in a way that it kind of charges them, it brings them, it builds their solo. But if also if I'm listening to them and then they're starting to play maybe a little bit more quiet, I'm gonna follow that and bring down what I'm doing. Maybe I do a crescendo on the cymbals or something like that, and try to give it some new texture to follow what they're doing. So it's a lot of listening, quick reacting, and not overthinking, not forcing anything. A lot of times I practice certain things to not use them when I'm improvising. And I accept that as totally fine.
Oh, that's really interesting. Practicing something so that you, in a sense, your body, if you go there, you're like, this is not the appropriate place for that. That you're almost practicing when and when not to use a technique or an idea. That's cool. I was going to make this its own episode, but let's just flow into it and spend 3 or 4 minutes just addressing this last subject, which because you've queued it up so well. What makes a drummer a better drummer? What makes a good drummer? What should an audience listen for to go, that drummer's better than your average? And I recognize that.
I think a good drummer is really dynamic. So not just playing at one level all the time, and really bringing the emotion into the music through the drums. Obviously having good time is very important. Not playing things that are, getting in the way. So just trying to listen and be complimentary, of what's going on. I think a good drummer is really knowledgeable. So I love to learn about different genres. It's almost like a historical deep dive for me when I'm learning about different genres around the world. And it informs my process sometimes. When I'm listening to music, I can be like, okay, this is more of a samba. It's happy. It's exciting. Okay, this is more of a bossa nova. It's more mellow, and maybe it's a love song. Maybe there's no words, but the title. And I've talked to the artist. I know that it's coming from a romantic place.
You remind me of a little anecdote I'd like to share with people. That Kenny Malone, one of the great session drummers of Nashville, the late great, he passed away recently, and he was famous, as we talked about him. Musicians who'd worked with him back in from the 70s onward said, Kenny was unique in Nashville sessions because he would go to country music sessions, and he would insist on having a lyric sheet, and people would say, Kenny, you're the first drummer we've ever seen who wanted the lyrics on their music stand. And he was such an energy-based guy and such a spiritual guy and such an empathetic guy that you began to sense that he was literally saying the message of these words and the way the chorus, the verses unfold and the story unfolds is going to influence where I put my emphasis as a drummer. And I just thought that was fantastically beautiful.
Yeah, and just really quick, I've been playing with some musicians. The keys player that I've been using, Alex Murphy, he's not a drummer, obviously. I said he's a keys player, but he's exactly the like that. He wants to know like what the song is about. He wants to know the story about it, and it informs his soloing and his choices, and I love that. So I think that's a I think it's a good musician thing. Not just a drummer, but yeah, I think a good drummer is aware of texture, though, just to get back to what you were saying before,
Great. Yep.
aware of texture and can change up the texture. So if I'm on the hi-hat, that's more of a crisp type of texture, versus if I'm on the ride cymbal, that's more of a washy type of sound. So that that is also something that I'm listening for. It's, you know, ultimately it's subjective. So if it makes you feel good, then it makes you feel good. What makes you feel good might not be my cup of tea, but you know, it's all good.
It's wonderful. I think we could agree that speed and power are overrated generally, and yet they're not bad things to know and have in your toolkit. The film Whiplash from a few years ago is something that, for the first time that jazz had gotten into the big screen and been in a movie that had wide release in a long time. And I was kind of crestfallen when I saw it, because it made the drum instruction that would happen in that movie look like it was all about speed and technique. And that teacher may have been that kind of guy, but that, you know, it was the wrong impression for me to give to the world that drumming is so much more about finesse and about the dynamics, as you said, about choosing when to emphasize, about it's about cueing the listener to perhaps a new passage. Drummers are big at transitions, and they are in pop music. That's why we have drum fills and cymbal crashes at the moment when the verse is over and the chorus begins, for example, or vice versa. And they're there to orient and create structure. They're there to communicate very deeply with the bass player. Can you talk about the relationship the drummer has with the bass player?
Yeah, a lot of times the bass player is definitely going to be heavily locked with the drummer, specifically with the bass drum and the rhythm that the bass player is playing. A lot of times those are going to lock in. They're going to match up at a certain point. So yeah, the bass, you know, the bass is such an interesting instrument because it's really the root of the harmony, and it's also the root of a lot of rhythmically what is going on. So it's, yep. It's an incredibly deep instrument. So yeah, I'm definitely wanting to complement what the bass player is playing, but not always, but sometimes, like for example, on my upcoming album, I've got a song called Skipping Stones. And the bass drum is actually doing something a little bit different than what the bass player's rhythm is. It's actually kind of a melodic line that the bass player is playing. And somebody actually said it was kind of sounded like something that Jaco would play, who's a really famous jazz fusion bass player. But anyways, yeah, if you're listening to this, you know, in 2023, my album will definitely be out then. It should be out by the end of this year. Mm-hmm. You can check out that song and see what I mean, that there's kind of like a contrasting part going on for the melody. When we get into the solos, it's a little bit different, but right. But great. Yeah, usually it's very locked in.
Yeah, I think that often in jazz, especially traditional jazz, where you've got a walking bass line, dun, 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 that many times the bass player is actually more responsible for keeping the entire band and the time centered and truly grounded, whereas the drummer in rock music is more clear, 1, 2, 3, 4. The drummer in jazz can often be more of a gesture and more making the rhythm then go into another level where it's not just a rigid beat, but one with syncopated ideas and making you feel, oh, there's a lot more going on than just a count, 1, 2, 3, 4. And syncopation is a concept I'll do maybe a whole video on someday, because it really is where things get funky. And for those who, like me, grew up with classical music and learning sort of the classical period or the Baroque period, things were really very rigid in a very grid-like kind of rhythm. But when you get syncopation, that's when you start to really move and you want to dance. It's a good place to drop off. I have learned a ton. I really appreciate you sharing your mind with us. And I was going to ask about the record, but you've come in late this year, early next year. Any last word about it? What sort of the vision is and how different it might be than the one from 2018?
Yeah, I'm really excited about this album. I feel like I've grown a lot as a composer and drummer and musician. I feel like my band has grown a lot, I'm very excited. The album will definitely be out by the end of this year. My next recording session will be in early August, and then after that it'll be in mixing and whatnot, so probably December is when it will be out. I'm really excited. It's a little bit different than
you mentioned. You mentioned more horn parts earlier on. Were you alluding to that this record may have more, a little more orchestral kind of qualities, a little bigger and more instruments?
Yes, there are some songs that have bigger arrangements for sure, and some of them are not large arrangements. But yeah, there's a little bit of a mix up with that. Yeah, I'm really, really excited.
You should be. Well, I am too, because we always want to be aware of how much change an artist can go through between a record in 2018 and a record in 2022. It's especially when it's music like you make, where the growth can be very intense, and the like you said, the band becomes more coherent and more knows each other better and more naturally reactive, and it's going to be great. So watch for the Sofia Goodman Group. We'll link to the band and Sofia's world in the description. And I just can't thank you enough for your time and your insights. And folks, keep following along. There'll be more content coming. And I'm Craig, and we'll see you down the road. Cheers.
Bye. Thanks for having me.
You bet.